goodness. This is Mountain Dew, this is Mountain Don't. But then you understand what Paul said. When I am weak, then in him I become strong. So you pray more. You study your Bible more. You ask God to fill you and seal you with his presence. And then Paul says, when you are filled with God's presence, through obedience and humility, when life comes, tries to squeeze you. I'm a strong man. I play football. But this day he says, be not conformed to this world. I'm trying to squeeze you. I'm trying to break you. I'm trying, but you keep popping back in shape. Why? Because you're no longer trying to do this thing in your own strength. You are filled with the presence of God. No matter how much the devil tries to make you look like this, he can't touch you because you are filled with his holy presence. And he tries. Eventually, he gives up. This thing is too strong. Are you filled? Please. You ever watch the TV show that says, don't try this at home? Can I tell you something? Don't try to be a Christian without Christ. Don't try it at home. Seriously. Don't think church tradition is going to save you. Amen. Don't think because you know the hymns by the children is going to save you. Amen. Don't think because you know all the rules of the church and you know the bylaws and you know all the history that is going to stand the devil. He left that. Ha! There's nothing wrong with knowing these things, you know, but not in itself. The devil is trying to kill me from the womb. You know I have holes in my body where the hanger stuck me. Yeah? I am weak without Jesus. But with him, I am more than a conqueror. Here's my last point to you. Are you a diamond? Are you a pipe? Are you a contender or a pretender? God's going to call you now to do some stuff after this. Amen. He's going to put some Goliaths in your way, some giants. He's going to see what you really believe. And here's the issue. Hear me very well now. I'm almost done. When God calls you to greatness, say greatness.
Greatness.
Jesus says, greater things shall you what?
Do.
Where's your greater?
Alright.
Where's your greater? What have you done that God would? Jesus walked on water. Jesus healed the blind. Jesus did some powerful stuff. But he said himself, greater things shall you do in my. Where's your greater? Are you making Jesus a liar? God, when he calls you to do something, hear me now. So that's going to take before I leave this place. When God calls you to greatness, he will always call you to do something that's bigger than you.
Amen.
It's bigger than your finances. It's bigger than your education. It's bigger than your experience. It's bigger than your background. It's bigger than your pedigree. It is something nobody in your family has done before. When God calls you to do something, it will always be bigger than you. Goliath was bigger than David. Pharaoh was bigger than Moses. That little boy who had 5 barley loaves, which maybe was poor, because the poor ate barley, the rich ate wheat. People keep this confused. They think he had 5 wonder loaves of bread. No. He had 5 crackers and 2 sardines.
He was a poor boy with a lunch.
Amen.
Jesus had to feed 5,000 people. 5,000 people is bigger than two little fishes and some crackers.
But here is what God is saying tonight prophetically to you from His Word. God is asking Glenville one question. What is in your hand? Not what you don't have. Not what you can't do. What is in your hand? Every time God did something supernatural, He asked the person, what is in your hand? He asked Moses, go to Pharaoh, who had swords and chariots and horses. And Moses said, he got all that. God said, what's in your hand? I got a stick. Well, stick plus me is more than Pharaoh's army. Go. He asked a little boy named David to take on Goliath. And God asked him, what is in your hand? Goliath has a shield, a sword, a helmet. All I got is a rock and a rag. But a rock and a rag plus Jesus will take off the head of Goliath. What is in your hand? He asked a man who had a dream. His name was Saul of Tarsus. He became Paul. You know what Paul's dream was? Was to get to the seven hills of Rome and to preach the gospel. You know why? Because at that time, Rome was the internet. L. Rhodes led to where? Rome. If you preached in Rome, they would take your word to the four corners of the globe. Paul wanted to preach. God, take me to Rome so I can declare the gospel. And guess what? God does. But He takes them in chains. He is locked in the inner cell next to a centurion. You know what that means? If you escape, he has to kill himself. So you ain't going nowhere. So Paul is locked in prison. He can look out the window and see the seven hills of Rome. And you can hear Paul saying, God, why would you bring me here? Why would you tease me like this? You know I want to go out into the city like I did in Philippi, like I did in Ephesus, like I did in Corinth, and declare your word, but you got me locked up. And God asked him, what is in your hand? Paul said, all I have is a pen and some paper. God said, write to the church in Philippi. Write to Philemon. Write to Ephesus. Write to Colossians. Write, Paul, what you would preach in a day be lost next week, but what you're going to write down in this jail cell will still be speaking 2,000 years later. Give me what's in your hand. What you can with what you have, with where you are, and let God take your natural and turn it into. He'll do it. He'll do it throughout the Bible. That's all He's ever done. Little becomes much when placed in the Master's hand. What is in your hand is enough to take this city by storm. Maybe it's to knock on a door. Maybe it's to bring one person a month to church. Get your 12 disciples. One person a month you work on. I'm going to take Julie for the whole month and work on her. Then work on Randy. But you take 12 months a year, you get one person. Because all you need is 12. You get 12, you can change the world.
That's right. Amen.
If you keep on doing what you've been doing, you'll keep on getting what you've been getting. What you going to do differently? What you going to do differently?
Amen.
What are you going to do differently to make sure this revival doesn't die? A revival is not a program. A revival is not a meeting. A revival is a commitment of a group of people saying, for such a time as this, we are together, we're going to meet like this, we're going to talk like this, and we're going to witness to God. We're going to be together, forgive each other, love each other, reach out to the community. Your schools are waiting. I went to those schools. Those kids are starving. They're starving. You think the word of God is old and phony? You think you'll have no interest? They are hungry for somebody to stand up and love them enough to tell them the truth. Talk to your pastor. Say, Pastor, I'm not in the game. Pastor, stand up. All pastors, stand up. Stand up, pastors. Stand up, your pastor. Stand up. I'm preaching. I got no voice left. These are your generals. Don't you leave here tonight without talking to one of them saying, how can I serve? We need help, Pastor. How can I help you in your church? How can I come to church and be a help to you? What do you need? Pastor, here's what's in my hand. I'm going to give it to you so I can use it. I know how to do carpentry. I know how to do electrician work. I know how to do plumbing. I know how to sing. I know how to have meetings. I know how to do typing. Pastors, turn to these people. Look at them. These are the people God has planted in this place to be in charge over your souls. They're good. I've gotten to know them. Our ordained pastors. These are good people. They love God. I broke bread with them. They're anointed. You can't have this kind of meeting and this